researchers have developed a new silicon-free microchip, and some are already calling it the fastest, most efficient microchip technology ever. I've spent the past decade designing chips, and I am particularly excited about this innovation, because according to this paper, we could be turning a new page in semiconductors. Let me explain. Silicon has powered computing for decades. It's the reason why computers have become smaller, faster, and more powerful over time. But will it continue to lead the way? Well, after a decade of marvelous engineering, it seems like we are hitting a wall. Right now, transistors, the building blocks of all modern electronics, are literally becoming quantum devices. The problem is, as the chip dimensions continue to shrink at 3 nanometers and beyond, we bump into the effects of quantum mechanics. And these quantum effects show up in a variety of strange behaviors. You know, it's a bit like when you're sick. Your body doesn't behave as usually it does, and you might feel dizzy and just off. This is exactly what happens when we face quantum effects. The behavior of electronic devices starts to change in ways we can't predict or control. One of the main effects that we observe here is quantum tunneling. This is a phenomenon when electrons are able to cross the barriers which they typically should not be able to cross. And this is one of the fundamental challenges of scaling beyond 2 nanometers. So, for a while, semiconductor industry has been looking for new materials. In fact, every major leap in computing history was powered by new materials and structures. You know, just like we went from germanium to silicon, from copper interconnect to light, from assembler and C to prompting with ChatGPT. That's why the semiconductor industry has been looking into replacements for silicon. And a new material is keep popping up. Bismuth. I know, it looks like a piece of art. But in fact, it's a heavy metal. And it can actually form these beautiful iridescent crystals when we melt it and then slowly cool down. Well, as you see, we have a lot to unpack here. So let's get down to bismuth. Today we are discussing this new paper published in Nature, very prestigious journal, where they developed and manufactured the first bismuth-based chip already in angstrom node. It turns out it's non-toxic, and it's something you might like to have at home, as long as you don't know that it's just slightly radioactive. And it turns out that China has more of it than any other country. It controls over 70% of the bismuth in the world. What makes it highly attractive for the next generation of electronics is its unique properties. And there are many, but among all, we are mostly interested how electrons are arranged around nucleus. Because it turns out that bismuth has some really interesting quantum properties. If we have a look at that, one of its key advantages is its strong spin-orbit coupling. It's a quantum effect where an electron spin is tightly linked to its motion around the nucleus. This is a very important property because it allows us to control the electron not by its charge, like in silicon, but also by its spin, making it a great candidate for a post-silicon era. But, of course, there is a catch. Bismuth has no natural band gap. And without it, it behaves more like a metal than like a semiconductor, making it actually useless for logic circuits. Now, what is a band gap? Imagine electricity as a water, which is flowing through a pipe. In a material like metal, pipe is wide open and electricity flows easily. However, in an insulator, imagine rubber, the pipe is completely blocked. Now, a semiconductor is like a pipe with a little wall inside. This wall is called bang gap. If the wall is small, electricity can jump over it when you give it a little push. But when the wall is big, it's very hard for electricity to move. And this means that by using the right materials with just the right bank gap, we can build very efficient and fast chips, which switch on and off exactly how we want them to. Now, when it comes to BiFMET, there is a fundamental problem, because there is no bank gap. So it won't work as a semiconductor. Of course, I would not be making this video if there would be no solution. It turns out we can dope it, so add some additional materials to the recipe to make a perfect semiconductor out of it. By the way, all the silicon chips are also doped. In this work, they use BiFMET telluride, and by doping it, they manage to turn it into a perfect semiconductor. Then, out of this new material, they've built a BiFMET-based semiconductor chip. And this was for the first time when this pretty crystal turned into a computing device. And not just that, it can also switch at terahertz speeds, far beyond what silicon can dream of. Here is a sneak peek at the new device. I will break it down in a moment. What's interesting, the entire stack here contains no silicon at all. The transistor device itself is made of BiFMET, and the interconnects are made of graphene. By the way, another new episode on graphene technology and the recent advances is coming out very soon. Subscribe to the channel now to enjoy it later on. So, after many sleepless days and nights in the lab, researchers found that we can use BiFMET to build transistors. And what's even more interesting, we can use it to create very thin layers, atomically thin nanosheets, without sacrificing the performance. Exactly what we are looking for the next generation of transistors. What's interesting, in this work, some of the transistor features are just 0.5 nanometers thin. So it's 5 angstroms. And you know what happens in silicon at these dimensions? Quantum effects, causing quantum tunneling, and we are losing control over the transistor. So here we might need to stick to BiFMET. According to this paper published by a team from Peking University, it turns out that BiFMET-based transistors have big advantages over silicon transistors. And the first one is switching speed. It turned out that BiFMET-based electronics can operate at frequencies around 500 GHz or even higher. Just for comparison, today's best silicon chips operate at frequencies of up to 5 to 6 GHz. But very important note here, this has to do not just with the limitations of silicon, but mostly with interconnect. And interestingly, in this work, they are targeting both of these limitations, because they used here graphene for interconnect. Simply put, BiFMET can enable new electronic behavior, and this goes beyond digital chip. And most interestingly, it may open the door to new types of quantum devices, new flavors of quantum bits, for example, and even more interestingly, devices like spectronics. Let me know what you think in the comments. Before we dive into the details of this technology, how it works, and the future of it, one thing is clear now. Whether you're a small business or a large enterprise, the technology that you choose today matters more than ever. And this is where AMD steps in. As I mentioned many times on my channel, I really admire AMD for pioneering new approaches. They were the first to introduce innovations like V-Cache, where they stacked additional cache memory on top of CPU die, and that gave a huge performance boost to many applications. Their new Ryzen PRO chips take efficiency to even higher level, delivering even faster performance for AI-powered applications directly on your laptop. Imagine your favorite tools like Adobe Premiere Pro or Midjourney running noticeably faster. You will also see a boost in AI applications from Hugging Face, OpenAI, Meta, and others, making your workflow quicker. Why to upgrade to a new laptop now? A part of efficiency boost, AI PCs powered by AMD Ryzen PRO series come with 6 layers hardware-enhanced security and Windows 11 ready. As you may know, the support for Windows 10 ends this October, means no more security or feature updates, which may potentially put you and your company at risk. So don't wait to boost your productivity and security with AMD Ryzen PRO laptops. Right now, AMD is offering businesses the opportunity to see the impact firsthand with their free loaner program. Use the link below to get a Ryzen PRO laptop, put it to test, and experience all the benefits it can bring to your business. Check it out, the links are in the description below, and thank you, AMD, for sponsoring this episode. Now, it's time to get back to Bismuth. Let's break down what exactly they did, how they did it, and why it's important. First of all, what's interesting, from the first prototype, they've built and designed the Bismuth-based chip straight away in the Angstrom node. So straight away in the state-of-the-art node. And that's cool. The Angstrom node is the next generation of semiconductor manufacturing, where feature size are measured in angstroms. And one angstrom is 1/10 of a nanometer. Practically, angstrom node represent manufacturing beyond 2 nanometers, and even further when we start to enter single-digit angstrom scale. The Pekin team fabricated a wafer-scale chip based on gate-all-around transistor technology. You know, all modern chips like AMD's processors or Apple Silicon are built with FinFET technology, where we have multiple fins multiplied horizontally. Right now, the industry is transitioning towards the next big thing, gate-all-around transistor technology, where we turn the fins on the side. So now, instead of placing fins horizontally, the nanosheets are multiplied vertically. And while in FinFET the gate is wrapped around the channel on 3 sides, this new design allows the gate to fully wrap around the channel. That's why it's actually called gate-all-around technology. And this new transistor architecture will enable scaling below 3 nanometers. What's even more interesting, they combined here Bismuth transistors with graphene interconnects. Interconnects are those tiny metal lines that connect many transistors into logic gates, which allow them to perform operations like addition and just to process information in general. You may have noticed that whenever we talk about the next gen materials, graphene is keep popping up. So why to use it here for interconnects? Graphene is a very interesting material. A part of its exceptional thermal and electrical conductivity, it's also very thin. It consists just of a single layer of carbon atoms. So it doesn't add much height to the stack, which is crucial for transistor scaling, especially now when we are starting to build vertical transistors and then stacking multiple chiplets vertically. Here, keeping building blocks as flat as possible is crucial. On top of that, graphene has high conductivity and provides extremely stable contact to materials like bismuth, which means minimum energy lost in interconnects. And if you read me on LinkedIn, you know why it is important. If not, let's connect. Now, how did they manage to manufacture this microchip? If we have a look at the gate-all-around transistor architecture, when it comes to manufacturing, the main challenge is creating these tiny channels and growing an atomically thin, 5 angstrom thin gate oxide around the channel, and then wrapping the gate around it. Here, it's particularly challenging because you can't directly see the underside of the nanosheets. Here, in order to build a vertical layer of nanosheets, they alternate the bismuth sheets with ultra-thin graphene electrodes. And at the end, we got four of these transistor layers laid vertically, one on top of the other. On the image, you can appreciate how each layer is fully enclosed in its oxide coating, forming discrete transistor channels, one on top of the other. As a last step, devices were mounted on top of a silicon wafer for mechanical support, so it doesn't impact the performance of the devices. I double-checked and there was no silicon used in the active layers of the transistor. Based on this technology, researchers manufactured the bismuth-based chip and then did all the measurements. They measured all the parameters we discussed, like switching speed, efficiency, and so on. And then they've tested this new device against transistors from Intel, TSMC, and Samsung. And according to the paper, the bismuth-based device outperformed all of them in terms of speed, leakage, and efficiency. According to the paper, the new devices are already 40% faster and 3 times more energy efficient than silicon transistors. And this, combined with graphene interconnect, already now exceeding the speeds of 7 to 10 GHz, reviving the clock race. Of course, TSMC, the leading chip manufacturer, is also working on researching new materials beyond silicon. Currently, their main focus is on 1D and 2D materials, like transitional metal disclinides, as well as graphene. Recently, collaboration between TSMC, MIT, and Taiwan National University made headlines because they did a common research where they used bismuth as a contact material for the next generation of transistors. So you see, leading fabs like TSMC is also already looking into bismuth. I'm personally very excited about bismuth as a semiconductor. I think it has a lot of potential. But of course, it's in the early stage of development, and its success will depend on overcoming manufacturing challenges and also scaling it beyond the lab. First of all, making high-quality bismuth materials with no defects at scale is still tricky. It's far away from the maturity of silicon manufacturing. You know, silicon has a huge, optimized global supply chain, while bismuth would require integration with existing manufacturing infrastructure, and this would include partially upgrading the equipment and processes, which will be expensive and slow. This work originated from Peking University, and of course China would love bismuth to become widely adopted for electronic devices, because they control over 70% of bismuth in the world. And this would allow them to ramp up domestic production without being too much tied to the silicon industry. What's interesting, bismuth highlights the general trend. In the coming decade, mastering new materials, not just improving existing ones, will enable the next leap in semiconductors, AI, and quantum computing. Now, I expect the transition to the post-silicon era to happen in my lifetime, and this is gonna be very exciting to watch. Let me know your thoughts in the comments. If you enjoyed this episode, please share it with your friends, colleagues, and on social media. I really appreciate it. Thank you guys for your support, and I will see you in the next one. Ciao.